Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to see you this morning. Why don't you turn to your neighbor and say, you're really good looking. Do you go ahead and do that? That plays out well for married people. It might play out well for some single people, too. You never know. But it is good to see you. You know, I can feel so much faith and joy and strength in this place. You can tell when you're in a place that has what Psalm 122 describes. It says, I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. You know, I was a young adult pastor when I started 34 years ago, and sometimes you could see in their faces, they were saying, I was sad when my parents said to me, get out of bed and go to church, right? And I knew my mission, should I choose to accept it, was to try to share God's word in a way that their hearts went from sad to glad. And like Tamara said, it makes a huge difference when your heart learns habits that causes you to experience the goodness of the Lord. Amen? So it's good to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. I'm really excited about this final message we're going to share in our United We Stand series. And there were two goals in my heart when we started this series. Number one, I wanted to encourage every believer to register to vote. And it's because I heard something shared, it was shocking to me. 54 million evangelical Christians, they say, didn't vote in the last election. And man, if that's the case, I want to encourage you. We're forfeiting our opportunity to keep things from being unleashed by the ungodly. Come on, somebody. Our vote's a powerful weapon, isn't it? And we're also not standing with people that God has spoken to stand for biblical values. So I hope when this series ends that you are registered to vote. If you aren't, contact us. We can help you do that here at Faith Family Church. But even more importantly, it was in my heart to equip us to be the kind of authentic ambassadors who are compassionate and clear thinking and contagious. And we're capable of sharing God's view in a way that captures hearts. You know, in our families, we're all dealing with stuff. And places where we work, we're all dealing with stuff. And in our nation as a whole, we're dealing with stuff. So I hope that you felt equipped in this series to be the kind of ambassador and the salt and light that Jesus dreams of us being. I want to encourage you, next week we're going to start a new series titled Infinitely More. And let me share the scripture that motivated the series. It's in Ephesians chapter 3. And Paul wrote this, now all glory to God, who's able through his mighty power at work within us to accomplish infinitely more than all we ask or think. God wants us to come to church saying, man, because of how I've learned to relate to God in my heart, God's doing more than I ever thought he could do in my life, and more than I was even asking God to do in my life. And we're going to learn from Paul's writings in Ephesians over the next few weeks. We're going to learn that when we learn to live loved more by God, then we end up becoming more, we do more, we win more of those battles, those spiritual battles that are standing between our desires and the fulfilled dreams that God wants to bring in our life. So I'm super excited about next week's message. And I want to encourage you to do something. I want to encourage you to bring somebody to church with you. You know, the Bible says that's how we share in the joy of the Lord. Because the joy of the Lord is Jesus was busy saving lives. And when we don't just come to church, we actually bring people to church and God starts working in their lives. That's called entering into the joy of the Lord as believers. So I'm going to encourage you to do that next week. I encourage you to do this about 10 times a year, to look around you and just ask, have I brought anybody to church this year? Have I invited anybody to church? And I promise you, if you bring them next week, God's gonna talk to them in their heart and God's going to draw them to himself. Amen? Well, let's pray together. Lord, as we come to this final message, I pray for every one of our hearts that, Lord, you'll convince us that the contagious behavior that you call us to really is the answer to the things that we're talking to you about. Lord, help us turn our hearts to what you know is going to bring forth the answers to our prayers. In Jesus' name, amen. It's work to really mature your heart in beliefs that bring forth God's best in our life, right? And it's even more work if we live with the discipline that causes those beliefs to turn into behaviors that causes our lives to be blessed. And so today we're going to study a story where Jesus is talking to us about beliefs that he knows are better and behavior that he knows is better. And he's going to talk to us about how it's going to bring forth more of the best that God's dreaming about in our lives and in the lives of people around us. Now, it's a common story. A lot of us are probably heard of the story of the Good Samaritan, and it's one of Jesus' most popular parables, and in this story, he begins to talk to us about the fact that beliefs and behaviors are both very, very important in our life. And the story starts in verse 25 when Jesus says that on one occasion, this expert in the law stood up and tested him. Teacher, he asked, what must I do if I want to inherit eternal life? So we're going to see in just four more verses that this religious leader really didn't want to learn from Jesus. What he wanted to do was justify the way he believed, and what he wanted to do was justify the way that he was behaving. But he came to Jesus, and Jesus talked to him about something that all of us really deal with as disciples in the Lord, and that is it's so easy to come to church and you debate the scripture and you discuss the scripture with other people, but it takes work to become the kind of believer who's behaving like disciples are called to behave so that we see God bring the change that he wants to bring about through us. And Jesus challenged this man who had a reputation for being a religious expert. And Jesus asked him, what's written in your law? How do you read it? And he answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your strength and all your mind. And then this, I believe, really caught Jesus' attention. He said to him, and we're supposed to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. And Jesus answered him this way. He said, you answer correctly. If you do this, you're going to live. But this man, wanting to justify himself, asked Jesus this question, then who is my neighbor? And this is what caused Jesus to tell the story that he told that we're going to study today. But before we learn what was in the head of Jesus, I want us to feel what was in the heart of Jesus. And Luke, the gospel writer, really helps us with that, because this story really didn't start in Luke chapter 10 in Luke's heart, but it started in Luke chapter 9. And in Luke chapter 9, Jesus was coming from the northern part of Israel, and he was going to go to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover feast with his disciples for the last time. Then he was going to die on the cross for all of our sins. And the Bible says something really interesting happened as Jesus was on this journey. He came to the city of Samaria, and it says that he sent messengers on ahead, and he went to this Samaritan village to get things ready, but the people there didn't welcome Jesus because he was headed for Jerusalem. And whenever the disciples, James and John, saw this, they said to the Lord, Lord, do you want us to call fire down from heaven to destroy these guys? And Jesus looked back at them, and he thought that execution was a little bit extreme in this case. And the Bible says Jesus turned and he rebuked his disciples for saying that about the Samaritans. Now, this tells us something before we study the passage of the Good Samaritan, and that is that Samaritans and Jews despised each other. I mean, it was worse than Aggie fans and Longhorn fans. Can you say amen? It was worse than Cowboy fans and Washington, whatever they are, fans. It was way worse than that. And Jesus was talking to them because he wanted to bring forth better belief and better behavior that was going to have a much greater outcome. Now, let me talk about why there was such hostility in their hearts. And it's because there were religious differences that caused them to be really upset with each other. And it started in 932 BC whenever Solomon was king and he sinned. And these people in Samaria split off from Israel and they formed their own country. And that wasn't the worst part, because it was actually prophesied that this would happen because of the sins of Solomon. But then after they split off, they started intermarrying with pagan people and they started serving their gods and committing idolatry. And really, it causes a lot of hostility when believing people see people become unbelieving people, and the values they live with begin to affect our family, and the values they live with begin to affect the place we work at, and the values they live with begin to affect even our prosperity as a nation. And so there was great antagonism between these two groups of people, because on one side, the Jews felt like the Samaritans weren't pure, they were polluted, they were living in a way that was damaging to the nation. And on the other side, the Samaritans felt like the Jews were judgmental and condemning and not caring at all. Now, I hope you're following me, because that's really kind of what's happening in the United States today. Is on one hand, you have Christians who say there are values that if we're not careful, these bad values are going to destroy our entire nation. And on the other hand, we have people who don't know God, and they're saying, but I kind of see Christians as condemning and judgmental, and as people don't care enough about the things that I care about. And that's what was in the heart of Jesus when he taught this powerful parable about our belief and our behavior. Now, I want to add one more thing before we go into the parable, and that is that Jesus had already taught them how he wanted them to relate to the Samaritans individually. There's a story where Jesus spoke to a Samaritan woman by Jacob's well, and at first she was shocked because, according to John 4, verse 9, the Bible says that Jews weren't supposed to associate with Samaritans. And she had gone to the well in the afternoon to draw her water. Now, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to know the best time to draw water is in the morning when it's cool out of the well. But because she wasn't living the best life, she went to the well when nobody would be there to criticize her or to look down upon her. And Jesus did something that stunned her. Next, he began to call out her life as a prophet of God. He said, you know what? You need some water. You're thirsty inside. And he said, you know, I know something about you by the Spirit of God, and that is you've been married 5 times, and now the man that you're living with isn't even your husband. And when Jesus said that, she was shocked, and she said back to the Lord, I can see that you're a prophet. And what Jesus did next is so insightful, because first of all, Jesus began to talk to her about how she was raised as a Samaritan, and whenever they intermarried with pagan people and they committed adultery, they began to accept theology that came from all over the place. And Jesus wanted her to know that who she looked to for the theology of her life wasn't as accurate or as trustworthy as maybe she thought that they were. And Jesus started by saying this to her in John 4:22. He said, you Samaritans worship what you don't know. And we Jews, and Jesus called himself a Jew, he said, we worship what we do know. And for some people here, that's where you're at today. What you worship is just a collection of what grandma said, and a collection of stuff you've heard on TV, and a collection of the spirit of our society. And honestly, it's not until we begin to read the Bible and God convinces us that this book is God-breathed. It's not like any other book in the whole wide world. It's not until that point that we come in touch with the truths that can transform our life and can take the oppression that sin has brought in our lives and can turn it into the blessing that God dreams about bringing into our lives. And that's why as believers, we can't compromise the truth, because if we compromise the truth, we take away the foundation that you need to have a blessed future. But though Jesus affirmed the truths that the Jews taught, he didn't affirm their behavior. In fact, in the next verse, he said, now time is coming, and it now is, whenever true worshipers are going to worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth. For those are the kind of worshipers that the Lord seeks. And what Jesus was saying was that even though God totally affirmed the belief of the Jews, God didn't affirm the behavior of the Jews, because it was condemning and it was hypocritical and it was something that God needed to change. And so now let's go to the parable where this religious man asked Jesus the question, so who's my neighbor? Now let me ask you a question. How many of y'all ever watched Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood? Would you lift your hand this morning if you watched it? I knew I'd see more female hands go up than male hands, and I knew I'd see women smile and men just kind of put their head down when I asked that question. But think with me this morning. Mr. Rogers, though his temperament was a temperament that was connecting with children, he's respected by people all over the world for good reason. And do you remember how he'd start his show? Because right out of the gate in Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, he was beginning to pursue what was in his heart. He would put on his sweater, and then he'd put on his sneakers, and he would begin to sing about his neighborhood, and he would close with this question, won't you be my neighbor? Now, I know Tamara's really glad I didn't sing that too much this morning, but think about it with me. What was going on in the world when Mr. Rogers debuted his show in 1968? And by the way, it lasted 31 years and 895 episodes. He became an instant celebrity with people overnight. And what was it that caused that to happen through Mr. Rogers? Well, think about the world he came into. That first of all, we had a president assassinated in 1963, and then his brother ran for president, and he was assassinated the very year that Mr. Rogers debuted his show. Then we had the Vietnam War that was going on. We had racial riots all across the United States. So if you think that we're living in a day that America's never been through before, you're wrong. But can I tell you something else? The 1960s, a revival broke out in this country, and I'm here to tell you a revival is going to break out again in this country if believers do the right thing. And that's what Jesus saw as he was heading to Jerusalem to die. He was thinking about his believers and how they would behave and what it would mean to the world. And Jesus began to talk to them about five things that he said will take us from just being correct in our belief to living with the kind of contagious behavior that can change the world. And do you remember what Paul said in Colossians 3:12? He said, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, we're to clothe ourselves with compassion, with kindness, with humility, with gentleness, and with patience. In other words, just as Mr. Rogers clothed himself to open people's hearts, the Apostle Paul said it's important we learn to clothe ourselves as Christians and that we relate to people as Jesus is going to teach us to relate. And number one, Jesus said that he wanted his church to care more locally. Jesus answered the question, who's my neighbor, with a story. He said there was a man who was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he was attacked by robbers who stripped him of his clothes, and they beat him, and they went away, leaving him half dead. Jesus was describing a hellish occurrence that happened often in those people's nation, and that was people would get stripped and beaten on this certain road that went from Jericho to Jerusalem. And Jesus was traveling with a band of people from northern Israel, and they were coming to Jerusalem like they often did for the feast three times a year, and all of them knew the road that Jesus was talking about. That when you got to Jericho and you started going up to Jerusalem, you would go through wilderness and you would go through places where it was easy for robbers to hide. And if they found they had more strength than you did, they would do something that would damage your life. And so here's what Jesus was saying is, listen, have you guys noticed how much people are hurting and nobody seems to care anymore? Have you noticed how much pain doesn't even make the 6 o'clock news like it used to? Have you noticed how much people's homes are hurting? How much their kids are hurting? Have you noticed how many people are on drugs? How many people are living in oppression because they don't even know how to live in the blessing of the Lord anymore? And Jesus was dealing with the fact that, yeah, in our day, we can turn great preaching on TV, and I'm thankful that we can preach and come into people's homes by television. Through the internet, we can access the greatest preachers all over the world. But listen, people don't care about what you're hearing through your ear in the podcast. They want to know if they have your ear whenever they're in pain as a person. Can you say amen? Listen to Ephesians 3:10. It says, God's intent was now through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms. In other words, God said, it was never my plan for the church just to listen to content, get on their merry way, and not do anything about the hurts of society. TV preachers can't take care of this, and internet preachers can't take care of this. There are things that principalities and powers do to people. There are things that the evil spirits in the world do to people. all. And Jesus said, I want my church to live with beliefs and to practice behavior that makes a difference about the pain that people are experiencing in the world. The next thing Jesus talked about was we're called to help gracefully. He said that after this man was left half dead, that a priest happened to go down the same road. And when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. He felt like he was too busy, and maybe he didn't want to disappoint the man by doing nothing. And then Jesus said, so to a Levite, when he came to the place and he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So Jesus is talking about the fact that there are people who are religious leaders, like this religious expert who was talking to Jesus, who had justified himself, and he said, I believe the right things. I think I'm believing better than most people are believing. I think I'm behaving better than most people are behaving. And Jesus said, if you knew the vision that I had for the church, you would know that the belief and the behavior is something we need to ramp up a little bit around here. And Jesus then introduces the hero of the story and how shocked they had to be when it was a Samaritan who was despised by the Jews. Now, if you've ever been profiled as a person, you know what it's like to feel what the Samaritans felt. I've been profiled as a person. I've been in countries like Uganda, and when you're white and your hair is red and everybody else is black, they know you're an American, and whatever they think about Americans, they're thinking about you, right? Or even worse, I remember when I went to Oral Roberts University, it's a Christian university, and the baseball players there are known for dipping snuff and for doing things that the Bible tells us we shouldn't do. And so one of my favorite things to do as a student, and also a baseball player, was when my ornery side didn't just have quite enough inspiration and satisfaction, I would sit in a part of the cafeteria by myself, and I would wait for a girl to come by who I thought I had a chance at. Can you say amen? And I would ask her to sit down, and right whenever I got her to the point where I thought that maybe she'd want to go out with me, I would tell her that I lived in the athletic dorm. And when I said that, it was like, get out of here. I don't want to go out on a date with you because I heard about those guys down in the athletic dorm. And Jesus is basically saying, can I tell you something else? I want you to know that the people who can make a big difference may not even be people who believe that they can make a difference. And can I tell you, that's what I love about Jesus. Jesus was the person who could look at Saul when he was persecuting the church, and he could say, I know what other people believe about you, Saul, but I'm going to share the good news with you, and you might be one of my best ambassadors whenever I'm done. Jesus could look at people broken by immorality, like Mary Magdalene or the woman who was caught in adultery, and Jesus would bless them in that state to the point that once they were blessed, they became the greatest missionaries of his mercy, and they changed people's lives more than anybody. Come on, somebody. That's what God's going to help his church empower people to do in the days ahead. Amen? Jesus said, I don't want you just believing things kind of right and behaving kind of right. I want my church to really care about what's going on locally, and I want them to really help people gracefully. And then here's the third thing, and that is Jesus said, I want them to minister redemptively. The Bible says that Jesus talked about the Samaritan, said he went to him and he bandaged his wounds. He poured on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey and he brought him to an inn and he took care of the man there. And this is where some of us can really see something I think so important, because I wasn't raised in a Bible-believing church. And I remember that it didn't take me long whenever I was in church to come to the point where I realized that the church is kind of like Noah's Ark, that you kind of come because of the storms on the outside, but then sometimes you want to leave because of the stink on the inside. Can you say amen? And Jesus was talking about how, you know what? There's something that happens in church that is unique and it's important, and it's why every single one of us should be a part of the church. And that is at the church, we pour values into people's lives and we pour the presence of God into people's lives, and that's what makes all the difference in the world. The oil in the scripture represents the Holy Spirit. And Jesus said, I don't just want you picking people up with pity, but I want you to minister God's presence to them until they go go from being oppressed to blessed. And then I love this, that Jesus spoke of the oil first, and he talked about the wine second. And the wine represents the blood of Jesus Christ. And if you really start pouring God's presence well into a human heart, can I tell you what's going to happen? Pretty soon, people are going to say, man, but I've got guilt, I've got shame, I have a hard time believing in myself. And it's not enough to just pour in the oil, we got to pour in the blood too. We got to tell them, forget about your guilt, forget about your shame, forget about how many piercings you have, and think more about the one who was pierced for you, because you know what? If you let him in your heart, everything's going to change. It's going to be awesome, I promise you. Just be a part of church. Can you say amen? And then Jesus went on and he talked about a fourth thing. And that is, I want you to care locally, help gracefully, minister redemptively. And then he started talking about empowering corporately. And I love this because it says the next day, the Samaritan took out 2 denarii and he gave them to the innkeeper. Now, denarii were worth a lot of money. As a matter of fact, just 1 denarii was worth a full day's wages. So when this guy not only poured oil and wine and bandaged the man's wounds, but he took denarii out of his pocket, he was making a significant investment to give the innkeeper 2 days' worth of pay. And he said to the innkeeper, he said, now take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I want you to know, when I return, I'm going to repay you. Now, I've been waiting all morning to say this. Do you notice that this man, first of all, put this person on the donkey? Everybody say donkey. And then he took out his denarii, and he gave them to the innkeeper. And then he said, I'm going to return. In other words, he didn't just visit the inn every once in a while, but the inn was a place that he went. And do you notice he said, I'm going to take care of this man. I'm going to see that this man gets well. Now, I want us to see as we close the series that the problem with America is not the donkey. It's not the donkey, it's not the elephant, it's the people who have to lead the donkey and the elephant back to the house of God so that we heal this society the way that God wants this society to be healed. Now, I'm not saying one party doesn't have a better platform. We need to read it and we need to vote biblical values. But what I'm saying is this is a picture of the local church, that none of us can do for people everything that our society needs. But together, we can be amazing if we become the kind of church with the belief and the behavior that Jesus is calling us to embrace. Whenever it says he took out the denarii, that's our financial giving into our church. When it says that he poured in the oil and the wine, that means when we go out after church, we realize that yes, we get ministered to when we come to church, but it's so God can minister through us whenever we leave church. When he brought him on his donkey, he didn't just invite him to church, but he was passionate about bringing people to church who needed God to help him. And then do you notice he said, and listen, I'm going to watch him, and I'm going to make sure he gets taken care of whenever he's in church. I'm going to make sure he receives all the ministries that our church has to offer. And when Jesus was here, listen to what Jesus said in John 14, verse 12. He was talking about his ministry, and he said, I tell you, whoever believes in me is going to do the works that I've been doing. Now, that's pretty powerful. That's pretty challenging, because Jesus healed every manner of sickness and disease that existed among people. There wasn't anything that the enemy was doing to people that, according to Matthew 9, Jesus didn't do something and heal it and change it. But then it says this. It says that Jesus said, and not only are they going to do what I'm doing, but he said they're going to do even greater things than these, because I'm going to the Father. I know we don't see ourselves this way. I know we don't see ourselves as people who, if we work together as the church, we can heal every hurt that people have, just like Jesus did when he walked the earth. I know we don't see ourselves as people who are going to do greater works than the Lord. But can I tell you something, Christians living in the last days? Can I encourage you in something, Christians who are living in the book of Revelation, whenever all the things that were prophesied generations ago are in the newspaper whenever we open it up in the morning or whenever we read it online, can I tell you something? There are going to be a lot of people in the earth, and you got to decide which one you're going to be. Are you going to be one of the virgins who doesn't have any oil in your lamp and you're not making much of a difference in the world? Or are you going to be one of those virgins that Jesus said, half of my people are going to be on fire with the Holy Spirit. They're going to be making a difference in the world. How many of you are glad we got a lot of believers in Victoria County that are on fire for God, wanting to make a difference in the world? Amen? We got to make a decision, and we can't be like this religious expert who justified his belief and behavior, because listen, whenever we stand before Jesus at the end of our life, it's not whether we justify ourselves or not. We're not the judge of our life. Jesus is the judge of our life whenever we get to that point. Amen? So you say, Pastor, help me. How can I live a life that I'm going to feel great about for all eternity? This morning, I'm trying to help you, just like I'm trying to help myself. We got to care locally. We got to help gracefully. We have to minister redemptively, and we have to empower corporately. We have to be together what none of us could ever be by ourselves. And then Jesus closed with this, and he said, and I want you to live with a heart that restores mercifully. The story closes with Jesus saying to the religious expert, which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? And the expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. And Jesus said, okay, instead of you justifying your beliefs and justifying your behaviors, what I really want you to do is I want you to go, and I want you to do exactly what the Good Samaritan did. And again, Jesus used the Samaritan because he was telling us, it's not about your skin color, it's not about your background. I want to do powerful things through every single believer. Can you say amen? But then Jesus laid out the behavior because, listen, what God needs from us is better behavior. That's why the Bible doesn't say if we pray alone, something's going to happen in the hearts of believers and they're finally going to change. God doesn't say that. He says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from the way that you're living, turn from the way that you're justifying, then I'm going to hear from heaven. Then I'm going to forgive your sins, and then I'm going to heal your land. Anybody in the house that wants our land to be healed? Come on. Anybody think it's worth doing that? Amen? Now, I want to close by showing us from some statistics what Jesus was trying to get across from us in the story. Because we're fortunate in the day you and I are in that there are people that love God who do statistics, and some of them help me as a pastor see what I need to be focused on. And this comes from George Barna. And he wants the church to see something that's happened in just the last 10 years in the United States of America. Do you see this? In 2009, something started happening. 50% of people that were Christians were practicing their faith in 2009. But when you come to 2020, something happened. And that is people who used to practice their faith, whose beliefs and behaviors were stronger. Not only did we not get stronger, we actually got weaker, to where only half the people who were practicing their faith 11 years ago are practicing their faith, though they believe in Christ today. We could feel this happening around us, but this quantifies what we're feeling. Now, this blue line are people who they are believers, but they say, I'm a believer, but I don't practice my faith. That was 30% of people in 2009, but now it's up to 43%, 13% more people who say, yeah, I'm a Christian, but no, I'm not really practicing my faith that much. And then you have the yellow line. These are people who say, I'm non-Christian. And 20% of our country was like that in 2009. Now it's up to 32% of our country. So if you want to know what's happened in our country, about half the people who used to really practice their faith aren't practicing their faith anymore. And about 12% of those people say, I don't even think I believe in God anymore. Another 12 say, I believe in God, but I'm just not really into practicing my faith anymore. So what it really means is that we have a different amount of people who are sitting in these chairs. The first chair represents the practicing Christian. And that's everybody who's here this morning that you would say, you know what, I'm not a perfect person, but man, I love the Lord, He's forgiven my sins. I've tasted of his goodness. I'm never going backwards. I'm going to live in the blessing of the Lord all the days of my life. Anybody in the house glad that God's done what he's done in your life? But then there's a lot of people, probably not here today. Maybe you're watching online today and you're sitting in chair too. And here, you may just be saying, I didn't really experience the difference that it made. Maybe somebody offended you in church and you gave up on church. Maybe you never really read your Bible. Maybe you didn't know how to walk with God. Or maybe you just let apathy and the things of the world take away what's going to mean the most when you stand before the Lord. And this is a sad chair to sit in because you don't honor the Lord's day anymore. That becomes my day. It's my day to fish. It's my day to cut grass. It's my day to go run. It's my day to do whatever I want to do. And now you're no longer practicing your faith the way that you should. And then there's a third chair. And I almost sat in this chair when I was 17 years old because I wasn't raised in a Bible-believing church, but I was raised in a traditional church. And I started thinking, do I really believe that some dead Jew was raised from the dead and that because of that I can't go to these parties my parents don't want me to go to and I can't hang out with some of the people that I really want to hang out with? And I was getting ready to go to college and I was really, really close to sitting in this chair right here. And then I got in the Bible and I realized who God is. And then I started getting around people who knew how to taste and see that the Lord is good. And then some people started pouring some oil and some wine into the wounds of my heart. And I'm going to tell you something. I know this morning there's nothing wrong with any person. There's nothing wrong with our country that can't be made right by God if he can get enough people who will go over there and sit in that chair and practice our faith. Amen? So here's how I want to close this service this morning. I want us just to bow our heads and close our eyes. And first, let's just pray to the Lord. Lord, we admit to you that we justify ourselves too much. And we're becoming what you want us to be too little. And Lord, we shouldn't be condemned for that because you don't condemn people. But Lord, we make a commitment to you today to be the people that you need us to be. Now let me just ask these questions. Let's all stay in an attitude of prayer with our head bowed and our eyes closed. And first of all, I want to ask you, if you're in the first chair where you're grateful to God for how he's working in your life today and you're just thrilled for the presence of God and everything in you is trying to do your best. You're not perfect, but your heart is sold out to God. If that's you, would you lift up your hand? Wow, there's hope for our city with all these hands up in the air. Now, would you put your hand down? If you're in the second chair and you say, you know, Jim, I want to be in the first chair, but I got hurt and I got offended and I haven't been living the way that I should. Maybe I got apathetic, but I'm not living the kind of life that Jesus wants me to live. And today I want to recommit my life to the Lord. I want to live for God. I know my heart isn't where it needs to be with God. It's not even where I want it to be with God. And Jim, I want you to pray for me. I want to sit in the first chair. I want to get out of the second chair. If that's you, would you lift your hand too all over this place? Just lift your hand and wave it at me. If today you say, man, I'm ready to be a first chair Christian, I want to pray for you all over this place. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Anybody else? You say today, man, I'm ready to be a first chair Christian. Awesome. Right there. God bless you. Anybody else? You say today, man, I'm ready. I want to get in the first chair. I want God's blessing right there. God bless you. It doesn't mean you're bad. It might have been people treated you bad. It might have been you were treated like the Samaritan. But you know life's too short not to live in the goodness of God. If that's you, just wave your hand at me. I'm going to pray for you at your seat in just a minute. If that's you, wave your hand. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Let me ask a final question. Is there anybody here that you would say, you know, Jim, I was just about ready to sit in that third seat too. But I know that Jesus did miracles. He was raised from the dead. There's no doubt that he's God. And today my heart needs to come back. And I need to give my heart to God. I want to be forgiven of sin. I want a taste of God's goodness. If that's you, would you lift your hand all over this place? You say, man, I came real close to sitting in the third chair. And today I want to give my heart to the Lord. All over this place, just wave at me. Amen. Anybody else? All right, church family, you can look up at me. And hey, can we give everybody lifted their hand a great big hand clap to encourage them? And this was so encouraging last week. Do you know we had 16 people in our two Sunday morning services who gave their heart to God? How many of you think that's pretty incredible, right? And I just want to encourage you that that's with the COVID challenge and that's with masks. 16 people gave their heart to God. And I just think we need reminded sometimes that it's not whether we're in the midst of masks and COVID. How many of you know that God can build his church? All he needs is for us to give him the hearts he asks for. Can somebody say amen? I want to thank you for doing that. I want to thank you for living like you're living. And then I want to ask us all, can we put our hands on our heart and let's pray this with those who lifted their hands today. Let's say, Lord Jesus, thank you so much for coming to earth so we'd know how real God's love is and how incredible his ability to save lives truly is. Today, Lord, I say no to sin and I say yes to you. I know I'm not perfect, but I believe in you. And I believe that trust in you can turn new beginnings into great blessings. So, Lord, I give you my heart today. Amen. 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 Well, you can go ahead and give him a good hand clap. And real quickly, we're going to do two things. If you prayed that today, we want you to know we care about your new beginning turning into a life where God really blesses you. So we prepared this packet. In this packet we want to give you free today is a book that we've written, 30 Days to a New Beginning. It addresses the vital subjects that stand between you and the blessings that your heart wants to live in. And it's just 2 minutes of reading every single morning. It'll help get you off to a great start. There's also a couple of cards in the packet. One of them helps you and the people in your world begin to study the Bible so you can love the Bible. There's also a card that lets you let us know how we can best serve you and help you as the local church, because that's what God has called us to do. And then for all of you, these are available by the offering boxes as you leave today. And again, they're absolutely free. If you're online and you prayed that prayer, if you'll message us or text us or call us at one of those numbers they're going to put up on the screen, then we'll make sure you know how to get one of these as well. Then we're going to close this service by giving everybody an opportunity to give. And I want to take this opportunity to talk to those of you who are here today. And man, it's a new school year. And you say, Jim, I want to practice my faith well. I really want to know God. I want to make a difference. I'm a busy person. But how does a normal person have great experiences with God? How does a normal person have God do great things in their life? Well, in front of you is a card that looks just like this. The orange side may be facing you. It probably is. But on the other side is a blue side. And Tamara welcomed guests with the orange side. But on the blue side, we've developed a class that helps you learn to get to know God, who helps you. It helps you find freedom. It can be tough to break out of your past sometime. And we share with you how to break out of the past that's held you there for far too long. And then we teach you how to start living in the blessings and the fulfillment God's planned for your life. And you're taught how to make a difference in the world. And it's just 4 classes. It's not a long, long time, but I'm telling you, it's life-changing. And today, as we prepare to give to the Lord, if you're new and you really want the Lord to start doing great things in your life, through your life, you want his presence strong in your home, I would encourage you to take this card, fill out the blue side. You can also let us know if you want to be water baptized or something like that. And just put that in the offering bucket as you go out today. And we know our God's able, amen, to do great things in all of our lives. God bless you. Thank you for being in the house of the Lord today.
family, before you leave, let's pray over our offering. Can we do that? Our ushers are going to dismiss you, the ones that haven't left, and we'll get out of here in a good way. Amen. We thank you for being here. Let's pray over our offering. Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to give to you. Our resources make such a difference. Thank you for being in a place where we can be fed, God, where we can be encouraged, where we can be part of making something happen for you. God, we don't know that doesn't happen without intentional priority. So, God, thank you for people who honor your work in your house. Lord, you said if we put you first, that you will fill our barns. God, you cause them to overflow with your goodness. So we give with joyful hearts today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, Faith Family, wasn't that an awesome message today? Man, my heart got so stirred by that. You know, somebody said, if we're not squirming, we're not learning. How many of you were learning today? I was learning something. I'm encouraged to be a better neighbor. Well, I want to encourage you. I did not bring that card up, but grab a Bring Invitation card on your way out. Infinitely More new series starts next week, and we can give them to somebody and bring them with us, pass them out, but take some with you on your way out. You can put your offering in the boxes after service. Let me pray a prayer over you before we go. May the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, thank you for being in God's house today.